So we can have the assurance of salvation because Jesus shed his blood for us.
Hallelujah.
Because I have given my life to him.
Amen.
But in and of ourselves, we can never say, I am saved, I have arrived. God is still having to do a lot of work in us.
Amen.
You know, there's a lot of people who say, when we talk about spiritual things, they say, well, is this a salvational issue? A lot of times conservative Adventists, people will say, well, is that really a salvational issue? You know, clothing, what you eat, what you drink, what you wear, jewelry, is that really a salvational issue? And when people ask you that question, what are they trying to say? You really don't have to do it. You know, it's okay, you know, being a vegan, a strict vegan, yeah, it's okay, but it's not really necessary for salvation. And what they're trying to say is, you know, what people usually do is that if you have two choices, which one do you usually pick? If it's not salvational, you usually choose the easier side. Standards, that's why standards go lower and lower. I remember a conversation with a minister in Japan, and you know, he was saying, yes, you know, the health message is an important message, but it's like the curtains in the house. It's nice to have, but it's not essential. You know, it makes it look nice, but you can have a nice home without having curtains on your home. He said the health message is just like that. It's nice to have, it's optional, it's good, but not necessary for salvation. You can eat whatever you want to do this. That's not true. The clothing that you wear, the music that you listen to, the diet that you eat, whether you have earrings and necklaces and lipstick and all kinds of things, it may not strictly be a salvational issue. But when the focus is on salvation, my salvation, we always tend to pick the easier side and say, oh, if it's not salvational, I'll just do the easier one. And men, we're not, you know, clothing and ornaments and diet, maybe a little bit more oriented to what women. What about men? Sports, movies, the entertainment, the cars that we drive, it's not a salvational issue. If it requires sacrifice, many times we'll say it's not a salvational issue. And do what our carnal hearts come out to do. But you know, the 144,000 who stand in the end of days. There are people, a group of people, who will reflect the character of Jesus fully, who would rather die than perform one sinful act, who will stand for the right though the heavens fall, and their focus is not on their personal salvation, right? Because their focus is not on whether I will be saved. Do I have the assurance of salvation? They realize that this great controversy that we are in, it's not about whether you or I, whether we'll be saved. It's more about the great controversy is about God. Satan brings forth the claim that, you know, sinless perfection is impossible. God is arbitrary. God is unfair. He's given impossible tasks. There's no way you can do it. But the last day people, God's people, will show that it is possible. They're not concerned about whether I will be saved or not. They're more concerned about whether God's character will be vindicated. They're more worried about God than they are about me, myself, and I. That's where our focus will be. So when we talk about diet, we talk about dress, When we talk about our entertainment, or the car that we drive, or the sports that we engage in, or not engage in, it's not about, if I do this, will I be lost or not? The focus is, will this glorify God, or will it not?
Amen.
And when we come to it from that standpoint, everything is made plain. It cannot be a salvation issue. But does what I eat or drink, does what I wear, does what I do with my faith, does what I do with my spare time, will it glorify God? Or will it affirm Satan's lie that God is an arbitrary God? He just makes up these rules to make our lives here more miserable. What kind of attitude do you have for these things? So is it possible for the Last Day Church to vindicate God's character for them, to live in the sight of a holy God without a mediator? You know, we talk a lot about justification and sanctification, and there's a huge controversy in our church whether justification, we all agree that we are justified by faith, right? It is only through faith in Christ that we are justified. But how do you define that word, justified? You know, Dr. Desmond Ford, and many of you know his name, he came to PUC and he made a statement. He said, justification is just God declaring us to be righteous. It's just a declaration. It's a legal declaration that we are righteous. God, Jesus, died on the cross for us, and if you accept his death for you, you are justified and you are righteous. That is true to a certain extent, but what does that word justify mean? Take for instance a couple of other words here. Pacify. What does that mean? Pacify. Pacification. To make peace, right? You know that the pacifier, you give your baby, you know, the baby's crying, screaming, you give that pacifier, and it makes him peaceful. To make peaceful, right? So pacify. Verify. What does it mean to verify? To make sure, right? To make sure, to double check, to make sure it's true, you verify. Now, what about, let's see, pacify, verify. Let's do another one. I have another one in here. Purify. To make pure, right? Purification. So what does it mean to justify? To make sure, to make just. It is not just a label that you stick on. Justification means that you are made righteous. You not only are declared righteous, but you are made righteous. When Jesus Christ justifies you, he not only labels you as perfect in him, but he makes you perfect. In him. The instant you repent of your sins, you ask for the Lord to live in your life, you are made righteous. And that is the good news of salvation. We're not only declared righteous, but we are made righteous. Now, remember last 2 weeks ago we talked about the 1888 message, and Jones and Wagoner, along with Ellen White, who gave this the message of righteousness by faith, that it is only Jesus who can make us righteous. There is nothing in our own, of our own selves, that we can call righteous, right? All the righteousness, all the justification only comes from Jesus Christ.
Amen.
And E.J. Wagoner in 1891 said this: now we call ourselves Christians. That means what? Followers of Christ. But in all our Christian experience, we have left little loopholes along here and there for sin. We have never dared to come to that place where we would believe that the Christian life should be a sinless life. We have not dared to believe it or preach it. But in that case, we cannot preach the law of God fully. Why not? Because we do not understand the power of justification by faith. Can you make it any clearer than that? We have never dared to come to the place where we believe that the Christian life should be a sinless life. We have not believed it, we have not preached it, because we have not experienced it.
Yeah.
But, he says, if that is the case, we cannot preach the law of God fully because we do not understand the power of justification by faith. Justification by faith, when you believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, when you ask Him into your life, you are not only declared righteous, you are made righteous.
Amen.
Another one. That's kind of long. This is a long passage, so I'll just read parts of it. But E.J. Wagner, in 1901, this is taken from some of the great General Conference bulletins. When the General Conference got together, some of the sermons that these brothers preached, they would transcribe and put into newsletter. This is taken from some of E.J. Wagner's thoughts. Says, talking about the time of trouble, such as never was, during the seven last plagues, he says, during that time when pestilence and disease are abroad in the land, when the very air is pestilence instead of life, when the sun, instead of giving life, destroys vegetation and burns up the earth and scorches man, and when the waters, instead of being life-giving and refreshing, are polluted and death-dealing, during that time, God will have a people that not only in spite of their own mortality, but in spite of all the corruption that exists in this world, they will live clean, wholesome, and healthy lives. Do you believe that in the seven last plagues, the sun will be scorching, the water will be impure, it will be corrupting, disease will be all through the land, but God's people will live healthy, holy lives, not just in spite of their own corruption, in spite of all the corruption that is in the world, they will live holy lives, right? During the seven last plagues. 1,000 shall fall at thy side, and 10,000 at thy right hand, but it shall not come nigh thee. Only with thine eyes shalt thou behold and see the reward of the wicked, because thou hast made the Lord, which is my refuge, even the Most High, thy habitation. There shall no evil befall thee, neither shall any plague come nigh thy dwelling. Psalms 91.
Amen.
This is where the Lord will show the power of his life. That is simply the power of life that conquered death, the power that overcame the lusts of the flesh, the power that raises the dead to life. It is the power of the resurrection. That is the power that will sustain us during the seven last plagues. But now, here is where we need to listen carefully. Now, what we must learn is that the same power that will be manifested during the seven last plagues will be manifested during the plagues now in the earth, before those come, in which is filled up the wrath of God. Otherwise, there would be no witness. If this power could not be manifested before probation ends, there would be no witness to the people. It would not be a testimony to them. If we live a pure, holy life in the midst of corruption during the seven last plagues, will it do the world any good? Not at all. It will prove to the universe, the unfallen worlds, that we are safe to say. That God has worked in our lives to such a remarkable degree that even during the time of trouble, we can live pure, holy lives. It will be a witness to the universe, but to the people in this world, it will have been too late, because probation will have closed. So that demonstration to this world must take place before probation ends. And he says, but before probation ends, there will be a people so complete in him that in spite of their sinful flesh, they will live sinless lives. They will live sinless lives in mortal flesh, because he who has demonstrated that he has power over all flesh lives in them. lives a simple life in simple flesh, a healthful life in mortal flesh. And that will be a testimony that cannot be gainsaid, a witness than which no greater can be given. Then the end will come. This will be the kingdom of God manifested to all nations for witness to God's power. The kingdom of God is within you. 1901. Can't be any clearer than that. Ellen White fully agreed with the message that Jones and Wagner were given to the church during 1888 and a few years shortly after that. So it is possible, it is not only possible, it is imperative that we, as God's last day church, accept the latest human message. For the doctor first, his job is to, number one, diagnose, give the correct diagnosis. And then after he gives the correct diagnosis, what is the doctor's next job?
Administer the cure.
We not only need a diagnosis, we need the remedy. And Jesus Christ gives that to us. Go back to Revelation chapter 3, and we'll continue on. So here we have the diagnosis that we're poor, blind, and naked, wretched, miserable. I want to vomit you out of my mouth because of your Laodicean condition. That's the diagnosis. It's dire. We're on the deathbed. But God says, don't give up. I have the cure. I have the remedy. And verse 18, I counsel thee to buy of me gold, tried in the fire, that thou mayest be rich, and white raiment, that thou mayest be clothed, and that the shame of thy nakedness do not appear, and anoint thine eyes with eye salve, that thou mayest see. And this is the true remedy that the Lord is wanting to give to his church, the Laodicean church. What are these things? Three items. Gold, trend, if I'm sure you've heard a lot of sermons on this, so I won't belabor the point, but let me see here. Gold, tried in the fire. This is from Christ's Object Lessons, page 158. The gold tried in the fire is faith that works by love. Only this can bring us into harmony with God. We may be active, we may do much work, but without love, such love as dwelt in the heart of Christ, we can never be numbered with the family of heaven. So gold tried in the fire is faith that works by love. True faith always is accompanied by works, right? You can't say, I have faith and have not had any works to show. True faith that works by love. Not because we have to, but because the love of God dwells in us. 1 Peter 1:7 says that the trial of your faith being much more precious than gold that perisheth, though it be tried with fire, might be found unto praise and honor and glory at the appearing of Jesus Christ. So your faith will have to be tried in the fire, right? This path that we're on, it's not easy. The trials, the afflictions that beset us in this life right now, and I'm sure many of you right now are going through the fire. Spiritual fire, maybe physical fire, disease, affliction, financial, relationships, whatever it may be, these trials, this fire that we're being put through is necessary in order to develop in us that faith which works by love. It's part of the remedy that God is trying to give to each one of us. What is the white raiment that Christ wants to close us with? We all know this one. The righteousness of Jesus Christ and that alone. And we say it so glibly with our mouths, right? The white raiment is the robe of Christ's righteousness. But it's not just a mental ascent. It has to be our practice, our experience in our spiritual lives. Because the whole problem with Laodicea is that They have a lot of riches all around them, just rolling around on the floor are gold, silver, diamonds, and yet it is not their own. They are poor, they're blind, they're naked, because they have not made the riches of Christ their own. So that raiment which Christ is trying to provide for us, Christ's object lessons, page 311. Only the covering which Christ himself has provided can make us meet to appear in God's presence. This covering, the robe of his own righteousness, God, Christ will put upon every repenting, believing soul. Yeah. It's only, that's where experience and our mental ascent and experience collide, right? We can say with our mouths, yes, I need the robe of Christ's righteousness. But is that your experience, your practice? Or do you feel that because you are sitting in the pews every Sabbath, because you memorized your memory verse for this week, because you gave a large offering, I am now entitled to be saved?
Oh, my goodness.
That is the most fatal deception that Satan can bring you under. Yes. That we can have any part in making ourselves entitled, a fit to be saved. It is only the righteousness of Christ that can bring any of us into heaven. And that must be not just our mental assent that we agree with that teaching, but it has to be our experience. When we submit ourselves to Christ, the heart is united with his heart, the will is merged in his will, the mind becomes one with his mind, the thoughts are brought into captivity to him. We live his life. This is what it means to be clothed with the garment of his righteousness. Then as the Lord looks upon us, he sees not the fig leaf garment, not the nakedness and deformity of sin, but his own robe of righteousness, which is a perfect obedience to the law of Jehovah. Christ's object lessons, page 311. What about the ISAP? What is the ISAP?
The Holy Spirit.
The Holy Spirit? The conscience.
Yes.
The I, and this is from 7th volume of the Bible Commentary, page 965. Ellen White says, the I is the sensitive conscience, the inner light of the mind. Upon its correct view of things, the spiritual healthfulness of the whole soul and being depends. Our spiritual eye, the conscience, has to be kept pure, has to be kept sensitive. Upon this depends the healthfulness of the whole soul. So what is the eye sad? Our consciences, our eyes, our spiritual eyes are in need of eyesight. Because when we look through our spiritual eyesight, we think, oh, I'm doing pretty good. I have the truth. I'm part of God's Last Day Church. I'm doing pretty good. That's what we see through our eyes. But God says, you need some eyesight. What is that eyesight? Ellen White says, the eyesight, the Word of God, makes the conscience smart under its application. Not smart as in intellect. Smart as in it stings the eye. When the word of God, when the words of the prophet are applied to the eye, does it make your spiritual eyesight kind of blink? Does it hurt?
Yeah.
If it's not hurting, it's not doing its job. Yeah? If you're reading the Bible, and if you're reading the spirit of prophecy and saying, oh yes, that makes me feel good and warm and fuzzy inside, definitely some portions of that will. Encouragement and, you know, that's good. That's wonderful. But when you apply eye salve into your eye, it needs to hurt. And when you read the Word of God, when you read God's commandments, when you read the spirit of prophecy, spirit of prophecy is not, Ellen White is not just an encouraging author. She is a prophet of God, who had words of stinging rebuke, not just to the corporate church, but to us individually. The Holy Spirit, through the Word of God, speaks to us individually. And when we apply that eye salve to our eyes, it's going to hurt. I remember we did a natural remedies class at one of the churches that I was at in California. And one of the remedies we did was a treatment for making your eyes healthier. If you have like pink eyes or a little infection or something, one of the remedies is cayenne water. Cayenne pepper water. And we asked for volunteers to come and try this. And one very faithful young man, I think he was one of the Bible workers at the church there. He said, okay, he was like 18 years old, let me do this. He said, okay, I'll do it. So he comes up, you know, nice strong guy. He says, I'll do it. And so he gets this cayenne water. You have to let the cayenne particles settle out. So you only use the water part, right? Yes. And he puts that in his eye. As soon as he put one drop in there, he's like, jumping all over. It hurts. It smarts. But just for a few seconds. After you tear, it hurts for just a few seconds. Then it brings the blood circulation into that eye. And it heals up a lot of the problems with your eye when you do that. It is painful. It is painful. Mm-hmm. But that's what eye salve does for you. And God says, the eye salve, the word of God, makes the conscience smart under its application, for it convicts of sin. But the smarting is necessary that the healing may follow, and the eye be single to the glory of God. So that's where the focus needs to be. Our eyesight is focused on me, myself, and I. Am I going to be saved? If I do this, do I have to do this in order to be saved? That's not the question. That's not the focus that we should be thinking about. The eye needs to be single to the glory of God. The sinner beholding himself in God's great moral looking glass sees himself as God views him and exercises repentance toward God and faith toward our Lord Jesus Christ. The Laodiceans were not entirely blind, else the eye salve would have done nothing to restore their sight and enable them to discern the true attributes of Christ. Says Christ, by renouncing your own self-sufficiency, giving up all things, however dear to you, you may buy the gold, the raiment, and the eye salve that you may see. Review and Herald, November 23, 1897. So in order to buy these remedies, the gold shining the fire, the white raiment of Christ's righteousness, the eye salve, which stings our eyes, in order to buy these things, Ellen White says, you need to renounce your self-sufficiency. You need to give up all things, however dear to you. Mm. Yes, it does take a sacrifice. It is not easy. The remedies cost something. You need to give up all that you have. Do you know that series I do on the Ten Commandments of Health? And the last commandment says what? Thou shalt not covet. Thou shalt not covet. Ellen White says, the greatest sin that exists in his church today, our church today, is covetousness. Selfishness. Covetousness is the greatest sin that exists in the church today. The right diagnosis and the sufficient remedy that will heal our disease. And then verse 19. As many as I love, I rebuke and chasten. Be zealous, therefore, and repent. I rebuke and I chasten. You know, that smarting eye salve. And this diagnosis, it's no fun. It's no fun to be told by your doctor that you have cancer and you only have weeks to live. That's no fun. But the great physician, Jesus Christ, says, I love you, That's why I rebuke you, I say to you, be zealous therefore and repent. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If any man hear my voice and open the door, I will come into him and will sup with him and he with me. To him that overcometh will I grant to sit with me in my throne, even as I also overcame and am set down with my Father in his throne. He that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches. You know, those last few verses there, as Christ is talking to the Laodicean church, he says, I stand at the door of your heart, and I'm knocking. He's knocking outside your door because you haven't let him in. You haven't let him into your heart. Does Christ ever force his way into anybody's heart?
No.
He never does. He waits for the invitation. He can only wait for your invitation. Can Christ enter into a heart where sin and selfishness also reside?
No.
Christ can only enter into a heart that is emptied of self, that is emptied of self-sufficiency, of sin. Christ will come in and purify that sin. But you have to let him in. You have to give up all that you have, all that you are. Because it's going to take a sacrifice. You can only choose one master. We're all slaves. No matter how you cut it, we're all slaves. You're either a slave to sin and death, or you're a slave to Christ and righteousness and eternal life. You can only choose one or the other. Jesus Christ will not share your heart with Satan. If he's in there, Jesus Christ says, I can't come in. You have to make that sacrifice. And when you look at the sacrifice that Jesus Christ made for you, how can any one of us say, yes, Lord Jesus, I want you, I open the door, I want you in, but you know, here in my closet, I'm gonna reserve in here. You know, I have a few things that I can't get rid of. You know, maybe it's my cheese or the clothing that I have, the immodest clothing that I wear, or maybe it's my television shows that I have to watch. And you know, everyone watches and everyone enjoys the Seattle Seahawks, and I can't give that up. You know, it is a battle between huge men who beat each other up and give each other concussions, and they glorify in violence and glorify man's pride. But you know, anyone watches it, it's hard. Is it harmless? Is it glorifying the Lord? I might have stepped on a few toes here, but ask yourself, as you apply God's eyesight, the Word of God, as you apply the Spirit of prophecy to your lives, is it smarting? Is it pricking your conscience? Is it making the tears come out of your eye? That's a good thing. The remedy is working. You must give up all.